Hello, everybody. My name is Josh Swann, and I'm currently a consulting engineer at Exponent. And I'm very excited to be here today talking with you about some of the work I conducted at the University of Maryland with Dr. Stolyarov during my graduate studies, looking at constructing comprehensive pyrolysis models to determine pyrolysis and combustion properties of highly charring and intumescent materials. Today, we're going to specifically be looking at polyvinyl iodine fluoride. To provide just a very brief overview of the direction of this talk, we're going to first be looking at some of the motivation and objectives of this study before jumping into some of the experimental work and modeling of both milligram scale and gram scale experiments, and then finally analyzing the char structure to determine what the pores look like inside of these pyrolyzing materials. So why are we even interested in looking at modeling or creating comprehensive pyrolysis models for synthetic polymeric materials? It's because these materials, like PVDF, have become increasingly popular in the built environment due to the large availability of raw materials to produce these synthetic polymers, as well as the fact that you can control and manipulate the physical properties to meet specific application needs. However, the inherent flammability of these polymeric materials pose a significant fire hazard in today's society. As the materials decompose and pyrolyze, they're going to heat up, release some gaseous volatiles that are going to mix with the surrounding oxygen, and eventually ignite, creating a flame front that's going to produce additional heat going back into the system, and it's going to increase that combustion process. However, char production and intumescence are mechanisms that are qualitatively known to reduce a material's flammability. However, it is not very well understood, and it's primarily through a guess and check or trial and error method in which this char production is introduced to these materials. So the two primary objectives of this work involve developing a systematic methodology and applying this to fully parameterize comprehensive pyrolysis models, specifically for polyvinyl iodine fluoride. And secondly, we want to investigate the relationship that may exist between the char's physical structure and the associated thermal transport. We're going to focus this work on providing this quantitative understanding in order to reduce the material's flammability due to char production and intumescence. A brief overview of the methodology that we're going to be using involves taking the comprehensive pyrolysis model Thermakin and creating inputs for this model based on experimental data collected at both the milligram scale to determine reaction parameters and the bench scale or gram scale gasification experiments, where we collect data to introduce some background or some baseline information for thermal transport properties. Once we have constructed these comprehensive pyrolysis models, we have the ability to predict rates of gasification or burning rates for many different materials and scenarios. So diving on in, getting a brief overview of this experimental setup, we're going to start with the milligram scale experiments. Before taking a look at our experimental apparatus, I want to look at the framework of our model, Thermakin, which was developed in-house by Dr. Stolyarov. We're going to be using an inverse analysis technique to determine the material properties, where essentially we're taking experimental data and we're going to fit parameters within our model to capture that experimental data. The modeling framework involves or includes mass and energy conservation equations here, where you can see we have terms for chemical reaction rates, gas transport, expansion and contraction, and finally heat transfer within our systems. These milligram scale tests are going to be thermally thin in nature, where we don't have any sort of temperature or mass concentration gradients due to the fact that the samples are very small in nature and heated at a relatively low heating rate. So many of these terms can be crossed out, and we're going to focus specifically on the chemical reactions, which are going to be described using simple Arrhenius form first order reactions conducted in sequence. This allows us the ability to determine the pre-exponential factor A, activation energy E, stoichiometric mass coefficient theta, heat capacity C, and heat of reaction HR for each reaction within our reaction mechanism. In order to get the experimental data that drives the parameterization process for our model, we use the simultaneous thermal analysis technique, where we're going to simultaneously conduct thermogravimetric analysis, TGA, and differential scanning calorimetry, DSC. TGA is used to measure the sample mass as a function of temperature during its thermal decomposition, and DSC is used to measure heat flow to the sample as a function of temperature. We're going to use a nitrogen atmosphere, very small samples, relatively low heating rates, in order to ensure that we have a valid thermally thin assumption for our parameterization process. So taking a look at some of the TGA data, we are going to use simple Arrhenius reactions using a single reaction at first, and we're going to estimate and provide an initial guess and compare these results to the predefined fitting criteria for our experimental data. If we're unable to sufficiently represent the experimental data, we're going to add an additional reaction and iteratively fine-tune the parameters until we obtain satisfactory results. In the case of polyvinyl iodine fluoride, we're going to find that we need two reactions, labeled here as reaction 2 and reaction 3, to adequately capture the mass loss histories as a function of temperature for the thermal decomposition of polyvinyl iodine fluoride. Next, we're going to be looking at the DSC data, where we are going to see at a lower temperature, somewhere around 450 Kelvin, that we have an additional reaction that needs to be added. This is going to be reaction 1 in our system. Reaction 1 is going to represent the melting, which is not associated with any sort of thermal decomposition, as indicated by the absence of a corresponding peak in the TGA data. You're going to see that there's also a drastic change from endothermic reaction to an exothermic reaction, somewhere in the 750 Kelvin range. And it's important to note that the exothermic reaction is often associated with highly charring materials. This process allows us to determine the heat capacity and heat of reaction for all the different reactions that take place within our reaction mechanism. Next, we're going to be looking at microscale combustion calorimetry, MCC data, where the MCC is used to measure the heat release rate using oxygen consumption calorimetry. And our tests here are going to be conducted in air. The heats of combustion of individual gaseous products are going to be determined with this process. We have the ability to parameterize or characterize each individual heat of combustion for each individual gaseous product within our mechanism. We're not using a global value here. So as a result of this entire process, we're able to fully develop a reaction mechanism describing the thermodynamics and kinetics of thermal decomposition for polyvinyl iodine fluoride, where we have three reactions that describe this entire process with the parameters completely defined and characterized. It's important to note that this entire process has been automated since I have been a graduate student, and I'd encourage you to listen to my colleague's talk, Comparison of Pyrolysis Properties of Extruded and Cast Polymethyl Methacrylate, where my Dushant Chaudhary is going to be discussing a little bit more in detail about this automation process. Next, I want to talk a little bit more about the gram scale experiments that we've conducted with our gasification apparatus. So going back to our modeling in Thermakin, remember we have the mass conservation equation and the energy conservation equation, where we have the chemical reaction terms that are now well defined based on the milligram scale test. So now we're going to focus a little bit more on the additional terms such as gas transport, expansion and contraction, and that heat transfer. Specifically, we're going to be focusing on the expansion and contraction and heat transfer, where conduction is going to be the prominent mode, but we're going to determine an effective thermal conductivity based on Fourier's law. But this effective thermal conductivity is going to wrap in a significant portion of radiation across the pores using the radiation diffusion approximation. Taking a closer look at our controlled atmosphere pyrolysis apparatus 2 experiments, or CAPA 2, this is the gasification chamber that I developed during my graduate studies. And here you see that we have an electric conical heater, similar to what you find in a cone calorimeter, that is able to quickly be placed over top of our gasification chamber or removed, depending on the type of pyrolysis experiments that we want to conduct. The boundary conditions are very well characterized within this apparatus, where the oxygen concentration is going to be below 1 volumetric percent, preventing any sort of flame from sustaining itself on the sample surface. The radiation conditions are known and well modeled as a function of the sample surface position. And finally, the convection is modeled as a function of radial distance. We use an axial symmetric geometry to reduce the dimensionality of the pyrolysis problem using circular sample shapes within this apparatus. We're able to simultaneously measure the quantitative sample shape profiles using a side-positioned video camera that helps inform the characterization process of the density parameters. The back surface temperature profiles measured with a non-invasive approach using an infrared camera are used to inversely analyze and determine the effective thermal conductivity K. And finally, the high resolution mass balance is used to collect mass loss rate data to validate the parameterization process later on after we construct the initial model. Taking a little bit of a closer look at some of the experimental data from the pyrolysis experiments you see here of polyvinyl iodine fluoride, we conducted duplicate tests at 40 kilowatts per square meter. In the graphs below in the middle of the screen, you see our side view sample shape profiles that were constructed based on the video images, and the black dashed lines represent the sample thickness or swelling or increase during the pyrolysis experiments, and the negligible gray shaded area between them represents the very small irreproducibility between the duplicate tests. We use a one-dimensional model here to produce this green solid line to predict the swelling or intumescent behavior of our samples during the pyrolysis experiments. It's important to note that we actually do have a fully featured two-dimensional axisymmetric version of the Thermakin that allows us to analyze the non-uniformity of sample expansion. However, here the one-dimensional version was employed because PVDF did not indicate non-uniformity. It was very uniform across the entire radius. However, a number of other materials, including polyvinyl chloride, polycarbonate, and polyether ether ketone, required the use of 2D modeling. And I have a couple different papers that you can read, and I encourage you to go check out to learn a little bit more about this two-dimensional modeling process. So now that we've recently demonstrated that we have a good handle on the expansion of our samples during the pyrolysis, we're going to focus on the thermal transport through the expanding intumescent material during pyrolysis. We're going to focus specifically by looking at the bottom surface temperature of our materials as a fitting target for the model development. Since the radiative heat flux on the top sample surface from the conical heater is well known, we can use the back surface temperature profiles as a target for this parameterization process. We do this by fitting the parameters of the back surface temperature using an effective thermal conductivity value until we can match and predict the back surface temperature very well with our model. Now we have a fully parameterized model, and we're going to use this to compare with our experimental mass loss rate data. Our experimental mass loss rate data demonstrates and shows two prominent peaks that we are completely unable to capture right now with this model, and it yields an error on the order of 50%. So we're not very happy with the results of this model, and that's going to drive us to further revise this model to understand what's going on here and look into these physics a little bit deeper through a parametric study conducted with our model. And since we are very confident in the development from the milligram scale side of the thermal decomposition parameters, the kinetics and thermodynamics of thermal decomposition, we're going to leave that portion of the model completely unchanged, and we're going to focus on the optical properties and the thermal transport properties. And what you're going to find, as I describe in just a moment, is that the emissivity value of one of the components is very sensitive, and there's going to be an instability in the surface emissivity that is responsible for these changes in the mass loss rate profiles. So during the parametric studies, it was revealed that the simulated mass loss rate profile was extremely sensitive to the emissivity values, the optical properties. So the emissivity value of the polyvinyl iodine fluoride melt component, the second component in our reaction mechanism, if we changed that emissivity value, decreased that from 0.94, which is the same as the virgin material, to 0.7 based on the fitting procedure, we're now able to capture and represent that first large peak in the mass loss rate data. So it gives us the ability to understand a little bit more that there may be instabilities in the emissivity values, the surface emissivity during the pyrolysis process. So to further confirm this, we conducted some experiments where we painted the top sample surface of our material with a high emissivity paint on the order of 0.95. And we ran the same gasification experiments, and we found that that first peak was no longer present, further indicating that there was in fact an instability in the emissivity on the sample surface. So now our model is being parameterized based on this mass loss rate data. So we're gonna further go along this same process to determine whether or not we can capture that second peak. So in order to do so, we continue to change these properties slightly. You can see here the temperature values do not change very drastically, and we're able to continue to maintain the back surface temperature. But now we're going to continue to fit the mass loss rate profiles, and we're going to introduce two temperature transitions where they were employed to create an instability in the value of emissivity of the char now instead of just the melt component. And this char value, the instability is going to be created by temporarily reducing the emissivity value and increasing it back up to that higher value in the range of about 810 Kelvin. And now you can see that our model with the red solid line is able to capture both of those two experimental peaks that we see in our mass loss rate profiles. So now we have a model that's fully fitted and capturing this experimental data at 40 kilowatts per square. And we're gonna compare that. We're also gonna conduct some experiments at 60 kilowatts per square meter and use our model to predict those values. And fully predicting these experiments at a different heat flux, it demonstrates that we have great extrapolating capabilities of our recently developed polyvinyl iodine fluoride pyrolysis model to simulate the Kappa 2 experiments at the higher heat flux. So now we have a fully parameterized comprehensive pyrolysis model that we're confident that predicts the pyrolysis of PVDF. Now that we have a fully parameterized comprehensive pyrolysis model, the second major objective of this work was to develop a relationship between the thermal transport within that model and the physical structure of the intumescent char. So we do this by creating char samples with our gasification experiment, cutting them open, and using different lighting and imaging techniques to get an understanding of what the pore structure looks like inside our sample material. And then we're going to run some additional analysis using a MATLAB script data. So first we're going to look at the pore sizes specifically, where the black represents the void space, the white represents the solid continuum portion of the char, and we analyze a specific portion of the char, and we're able to use a MATLAB script to determine the pore diameters and the relative frequencies, where you see that as the pore diameter decreases, the relative frequency of that pore size increases. Next, we're going to be looking at a porosity value, which is going to be the ratio between the void space and the total space. And we do this from a two-dimensional image where we compare the area of the void and the total area. And we find a value of 0.55. We also conducted this exact process from our models that I mentioned earlier, from our polyvinyl chloride, polycarbonate, and polyether ether ketone. So in order to compare some of these values, we know qualitatively that the char structure will impact the thermal transport through the char, but we would like to discover a quantitative understanding of the relationship between the char's pore structure and the thermal transport. So we're going to be looking at some of these the physical descriptors of the char itself and comparing it to some thermal transport properties. It's important to remember that thermal conductivity of the char is an effective value that is going to be dominated by radiative transport across the pores within the char. And finally, the product of density and thermal conductivity is going to be a measure of the char's transparency to heat flow. So here we're going to be indicating that when we compare all of these values and plot them against each other, there's going to be one prominent trend that manifests itself between the product of density and thermal conductivity and the porosity. So one way to think about this, as I previously indicated, is that the product of density and thermal conductivity provides a measure of the char's transparency to heat flow, where the thermal transport within the char layer is largely controlled by radiation between the pore walls. The figure on the right indicates that the larger the volume fraction of perceived char continuum, meaning pores smaller in size than 0.1 millimeters, essentially smaller than what you can visualize with the naked eye, the lower its transparency to heat flow. In other words, increasing the number of pore walls which is the same thing as decreasing the size of the pores, reduces the char's transparency to heat flow. Therefore, the most thermally insulative char is one that consists almost entirely of micropores, or pores that are too small to see with the naked eye. As you decrease the size of the pores, you're going to increase the insulative capabilities of this char. So this is a very important finding from this work. So in conclusion, we were able to demonstrate that we can create, through a systematic methodology and fully parameterized comprehensive pyrolysis models for intumescent and charring polymers. We developed new experimental procedures to analyze the intumescent char structure itself using simple, inexpensive equipment. And finally, we derived a first of its kind quantitative correlation relating the thermal transport within the char and the physical structure of the intumescent char itself. So with that, I'd like to thank you for your attention, and I would be happy to take any questions that you may have. Thanks again.